Thank you all very much. It is a real pleasure to be here. I sort of feel like doing the Monty Python thing and saying now for something completely different. But I've worked throughout my career. If you look at energy and the various sectors where energy is used, it kind of breaks down into three categories. There's industry, there's commercial buildings and residential buildings, and there's transportation. I've gotten the chance to work in all three. I started out as an intern at Nippon Steel Corporation, which was in Japan. It's a steel manufacturing factory, and I was doing numerical heat transfer for those guys back then. If you ever get a chance to see a working steelworks, it's incredible. You feel like you're in the realm of giants, and you see big vats of molten steel running around and pouring. It's absolutely mind-blowing. I got to work there. I got to work at the National Renewable Energy Laboratory out in Golden, Colorado. This is one of the Department of Energy's research laboratories. There I worked on transportation. And I was there for quite a while. That was 10 and a half years, looking at energy efficiency in transportation. And then last, I joined my buddy 2.5 years ago and in his company that is focused on commercial buildings and residential buildings. That's a big ladder software. So there's been sort of a theme with the things I've done and just sort of sitting back and thinking about it. One thing that sort of occurred to me with a book that I really enjoyed when I started out, 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. Anybody read that? Oh, great, awesome. If you haven't seen that or heard of it before, it's worth a look. But one of the things that Dr. Covey talks about is that all things are created twice. There's a mental or first creation and a physical creation to all things. You gotta think about something before you can actually enact it. And he goes on to say there is two creations to all things, but if you don't put any thought into that first creation, well, you get what you get, right? And so one of the things that's sort of been kind of something that I've realized is this whole area of modeling and simulation, it really is kind of focused on putting some thought to that first creation. And so looking back over the things I've done and the different tools I've used, I've been asking myself the question, how can we get better? I've worked on a lot of kind of niche applications, and I've been very interested in what's going on in the software world and what especially this community and you folks are doing, and what ideas can be traveled back to help in the bigger scope. So I'd like to talk to you guys today about a library that I've been putting together. It's called the Economy of Motion Library. It's a library for doing vehicle simulations. This is the area that I've spent the longest amount of time in my career looking at is trying to predict the energy use of vehicles. And so the purpose of this is kind of a play on words with economy. So we're talking about fuel economy, so like a notion of energy use, and then economy in the sense of kind of the economics. Today we're just going to focus on the fuel use portion. But you might ask why? What's the purpose of looking at energy and transportation? There are over 850 million vehicles on the planet right now. And you know, you throw these large numbers around, and for you guys, that's not a large number. You guys are talking about petadata and all this kind of crazy stuff. I don't even know how many zeros is that? Anyways. 850 million vehicles, how many are those? If we were to park 850 million cars and trucks bumper to bumper, we would get around the Earth 100 times at the equator. It's a lot of vehicles, and yet that's only one vehicle for every 8 people on the planet. So as you think going forward to the mobilization of people, is this whole thing sustainable? If we focus in on the United States and we look at the three areas where energy is used, transportation is roughly 1/3 of that energy use. If we look at the composition of the fuel used for transportation, we see that we are almost wholly dependent on petroleum. Now, you guys and gals are programmers, and we know sort of the problem of having explicit dependencies to one thing, right? There's a little bit of other things going on, renewables, that's for the most part ethanol, and there's a little bit of natural gas going on with the low prices of natural gas, but petroleum, right? Now, to add insult to injury, 40% of our petroleum is imported right now. And that's actually come down from recent years. We used to be much worse. And of course, there are a lot of other things associated with transportation as well. We have emissions, we have congestion, we have safety issues, and of course, there's the link with global warming. So, a lot of smart engineers, a lot of smart business people have been out there. There's a lot of different solutions. We have different business models, public transit, the urge to use alternative mode of transportation, such as bicycles, and you know, I've got no favorites myself, but you know, there's telecommuting. People are getting into self-driving cars, walkable commuting, walkable communities. Excuse me. I have this one here. This is really fun. This is up in the northern part of Australia. This is a road train. You just put a whole lot of cars onto a given tractor, and that's a nice way to get a lot of cargo across a space. And you know, in addition, we've got electric cars, we've got fuel cell cars, we've got biofuels, we've got plug-in hybrid electric vehicles, electric vehicles, my word. But the disclaimer is, your mileage may vary. And that's the point. There's a lot out there. How do we make sense of all this? If you are a fleet manager who owns several vehicles for your company, how do you make a decision on which of these things you should go with? Which of these things works best for me? If I am a city planner and I'm trying to maybe think about putting some infrastructure in for my city, how might I locate that? What things should I invest in? So kind of the idea is to try to make sense of all these things, and that's sort of the intent of this library. So I'm just gonna give you a little peek into what I've got so far. And we're gonna talk about two things. We're gonna talk about what makes up a vehicle model. So we're gonna think in the context of one single vehicle. And then we're gonna just have a brief demo. And we'll see how this thing works. So, let's go. So the different parts of a vehicle model. So starting up at the top, you have a duty cycle, which is how a vehicle is used, what the vehicle does, how it moves through time, what sort of different systems are on or off. We have the powertrain, which is the engine and all of the related components of the driveline that actually turn the wheels. We have also the loads, which is what the vehicle has to overcome in order to move. Then we have vehicle parameters and the environment that the vehicle is running in. And I also have duty cycle repeated over here. There's a trick that we like to play when we do this sort of modeling where we say, vehicle, this is what I'd like you to do, and then you can run through the system and get back some information about what it was actually able to do. And there's some reasons for wanting to do that. So the way that we look at this is running these all together then gives us a picture of energy use. So we specify all the things, vehicle, this is how you're gonna move, this is what you are, this is how much you weigh, tell me how much energy you use. That's sort of the idea here. Now there's two ways to actually go about calculating these numbers. There's what's called a backward-facing model and a forward-facing model. In a backward-facing model, we start from the driving profile and we say, okay, second zero, we're at zero speed. Second one, let's get up to 1 mile per hour. So in order to do that transition, okay, wheels, how much did you have to turn? What was your average speed? Okay, we figure that out. Okay, driveline, how much did you have to rotate? Okay, transmission, what did you have to do? And we get all the way back up to the engine until we answer the question, okay, how much fuel had to get injected into the engine in order to do all this? So that's a backward-facing model. We start with the end in mind and we worked our way back. A forward-facing model is a different sort of beast, and it is actually, it's really more related to how things really happen. So in a forward-facing model, you actually need to model the driver. And the driver has a target, and the driver presses the pedal and puts fuel into the engine. We get some torque, we get some speed, it propagates down, we get some turning of the wheels, and we get a certain speed. Then we need to close the loop, some kind of closed loop control system, and the driver says, oops, going a little too fast, slow down. Oops, I'm going a little slow, speed up. So that would be a forward-facing model. Now, the thing is, that takes a while. It gets you into iteration, closed-loop control. So what we have here is a backward-facing model that we're going to talk about today. So we're going to talk from the driving profile and then work our way back. So let's look at all these different components, and we're going to start with the loads. So our little cool cat in his cool Clojure car is trying to get to the conge. And you notice he does not use the guardrails to get to drive down the road. There's no scuff marks on the car here. But what is impeding the motion of this car? Let's look at that for a second. So we have the little circle up here is the center of mass of the vehicle. And we have acting on that, some aerodynamic loads. We have rolling resistance. Rolling resistance is quite interesting. This is actual deformation of our tires that impede the tires from turning and kind of keep us from moving forward. Since he's going uphill, he actually has a component of gravity that's acting against him. And there's another sort of apparent force from the inertia of moving the vehicle. So what overcomes all this? Well, it's our powertrain. That's the only arrow that's going to be going forward in most cases. Unless you're going downhill, you might be able to coast, right? So as we look into this more deeply, we have those four arrows called out here in the mathematics. We've got aerodynamic drag, rolling resistance, inertial forces, gravity. If we look at the mathematics of that, one thing that was really cool that we played at when we were at the laboratory is we were looking at this equation, and we asked ourselves an interesting question. We said, could we split these components up into something, into separate pieces? And in fact, you can, and that adds a little bit more insight. So some of these components belong to the environment, for example, the air density. Some of these components belong to the vehicle, for example, how much the vehicle weighs. And the rest belong to the duty cycle. And then the energy that you calculate has to be supplied by the powertrain. So, these are those circles that we were just looking at on the last page. So if we look at a specific term in this series of equations, here's the one for the rolling resistance. And basically what we can do is, again, notice that we have duty cycle, vehicle, and environment, and that creates the power for the powertrain. Now, I don't want to belabor this too much, but one thing that was absolutely cool, when I go ahead and specify the simulator, the way this works is I pass in four functions for the loads for this vehicle. And they are just functions. I mean, this is like, yeah, okay, this is what you do all the time in Clojure. But for me, this was awesome. I literally have pluggable loads. So let's think about this here for a second. So we saw that cool drone demonstration this morning. If we wanted to figure out, hey, what's gonna be the battery power use for that drone as it's flying around the stage or something like that, we might think of plugging it into this type of a simulator, right? This is what this thing does. You tell it how the vehicle moves, and it should tell you what's the energy use. So all we would have to do is write a force body diagram for that drone, put in the appropriate equations here, boom, we're ready to go. That's cool. So let's talk about the duty cycle. This is how the vehicle works. So this is pretty straightforward. We're just gonna, for this talk today, let's talk just about speed versus time, the actual movement of the vehicle. So we have time going along here, the speed increase, decrease, going back to a rest. And we can just represent that with a map, with some fields for the times, the speeds. I'm using SI units here. But when we get into the simulator, we chunk it up into time steps. So if I'm at a given speed and time, this is the target speed and time, and then we ask ourselves how much energy does it take to get there. This is a picture of an actual cycle that's used in the US for our fuel economy sticker. So if you go to a car lot and you look at the fuel economy stickers, they're gonna say city and highway mileage in parentheses. This is the city cycle, and yeah, I actually have a sticker right here. By the way, miles per gallon is a horrible way to talk about energy. I'm really, really happy. The latest fuel economy sticker has this gallons per 100 miles, which is more like how they do it in Europe. They have liters per 100 kilometers. Much better way to think about things. But one thing I want to show you here is just look at the difference in the fuel economy ratings between the city and the highway. And the point there is that the driving cycle matters. It matters to match the driving cycle to the vehicle itself. Now, I thought I'd tell you a little bit of a story. I worked with a refuse hauler. This was a company that was making one of these types of vehicles, not this exact one. And they were looking at a hybrid electric powertrain for this. It actually makes a lot of sense for this type of application. And I don't know if anybody has seen these. I think they're quite amazing. They've got a little robot arm. They go up to your trash can, pick it up, pop it in the back. This vehicle does a lot more than just driving. You know, it's got hydraulics that are compacting the trash. It's got the lift. It's got the arm. We took 6 weeks of second-by-second data, and then we had to compress that down into a 30-second test cycle. So these whole driving cycle, the whole point of this duty cycle or drive cycle is to be representative. So how does the vehicle really drive in practice? And there are lots of different driving profiles depending on the vehicle. Here's a smattering of different ones for different vehicles here. Okay. Vehicle parameters. I've represented this as just a map of maps in the Clojure space. One thing that's sort of fun, a parameter to me is something that's going to be a constant during a simulation, but you might want to set it in between. But the reason for having this as a map of maps is I've sort of found it rather useful to be able to enumerate different cases. So for example, if we wanted to look at the coefficient of drag, which tells you how effectively the vehicle cuts through air, we can say, well, the default is 0.28, but if I was going to take this vehicle and add a trailer to it, then I might want to capture that additional information. And similarly, the environment is also just a fairly straightforward set of data as well. So the powertrain, this is the real fun part. So this is where we say what is inside the vehicle and what is a powertrain. Basically, this is a powertrain as you would see. So we have the internal combustion engine, we have a transmission, we have the drive line going out to the wheels here. And inside the simulator, we represent that with these blocks. And we have the, again, we're doing a backward-facing model for what we're going to show here in the demo. And so we're going to specify the driving profile, and we're going to calculate what each of these components needs to do in order to meet that driving profile request. And in addition, you can get more sophisticated with this. This is a fairly common architecture for a hybrid electric vehicle. The thing that's new here is we've got a bunch of blocks up at the top. And that block set has an energy storage system, a battery, and has an electric motor and all that sort of thing. And we need to have some way of coupling these together to allow both of those inputs to turn the wheels. The mechanism that's typically used in something like the Toyota Prius is something called a planetary gear set. If you've never had a chance to see that, that is mind-blowing amazing. The mechanical engineers that came up with that, those guys would have probably been writing Clojure if they were around today, I think. So these components, I'm not going to really go into this, but they're sort of broken up by roles. And one thing that was really cool, I came here early for the trainings that were offered, and so went through the training on pedestal and everything. And so, you know, you guys are dealing with a lot of, you know, web servers and applications and services working together. But I was sitting in that pedestal class, and they put up a diagram on the board that looked a lot like my components here. And I was thinking, gosh, these interactors that they're talking about look a heck of a lot like powertrain components, and it sort of has some of the same issues of data flow back and forth. The way we handle this in the simulator is requested power is bubbled up to the back, and then the actual power achieved comes forward, and you have to have one that's eventually a source that sort of turns you around. Very similar problem, so I'm looking to steal some ideas out of that. The way I do components, I just have a protocol that helps to sort of abstract the different components, allow them to use a similar interface. There's one method that uses just for stepping forward in time. That's the step function. The other two are just used to tell you what are the possible max and minimum power that you could achieve for each component. So let's look at a demo here real quick. Okay, so we started off the talk looking at these five components, right? So here again are the vehicle loads, and if you can kind of see here, again, it's just a vector of functions. And so you know, reading into some of these, we've got aerodynamic loads, rolling resistance, et cetera. If we look at our duty cycle, again, this is how the vehicle is going to be driven. So I have two cycles here that are the city and the highway cycle. These are from the EPA's test procedures. And if we look at that, again, it's just a map with name for some kind of metadata to track, and times, and there's some speeds in there as well. Now, this is where we get into the vehicle parameters. So what we're going to do here is I showed two powertrain configurations, a conventional vehicle and a hybrid electric vehicle. So we're going to run both of those and see what the energy, what the fuel economy is for each of those vehicles. So the way they typically test these vehicles is you have sort of the gross vehicle weight rating, and you put an additional mass into the vehicle to represent the passenger and maybe some luggage. And so that's this passenger load here. Sorry, I've got sort of mixed kilograms and pounds and stuff like that, but bear with me here. So that's roughly the weight of a person and a few extra luggage items. So again, we can specify, this is just a map, conventional vehicle parameters. We can kind of look at this. Again, this is this kind of map of maps, where the second map value gives you the idea of sort of having enumerated cases. And similarly, we have parameters for the hybrid vehicle here. And then the standard environment here. I'm pulling these in from some different namespaces. But here we've got standard environment, we've got gravity, and we've got a function for air density as a function of elevation. And this is actually maybe worth looking at here real quick, just to see. So if we have, so I live in Colorado, so at sea level, so here we have this key, which is pulling the function of the air density by elevation out of our environmental map. And I'm asking it to give me the air density at sea level, so zero elevation. So if we look at that, we've got 1.2, and I've got a little library here, this UC convert length thing. This basically allows me to do unit conversions. And so I'm gonna do air density at 1 mile above sea level, and that gives me basically at Denver, the Mile High City, right? And so you can see there's actually a significant difference in these numbers. So this is kind of nice to be able to, I can choose if I want to model the difference in air density with elevation just by tweaking what's in the map. This is really cool for me, okay? I can't tell you, I started initially, you know, writing some of these things in C and C++ and even, you know, graduating to MATLAB and stuff, the ability to just tweak these things and kind of work in this simple abstractions and pull things in and out, this is awesome. The powertrain. So we're going to start with the conventional vehicle powertrain. I'm using the thread last macro, and I don't want to go into too much detail here, but we've got a function that makes an internal combustion engine. We're putting another component together that does the limits for the engine, accessory loads, driveline. So this is that picture that we saw before. We're just chaining all the blocks together. This makes the powertrain for the hybrid electric vehicle, whoops, running off the page a little bit, but I have two branches, internal combustion engine branch right here, and I've got an energy storage system branch, which goes all the way down here. That's where the battery and the electric motor and that sort of thing, and those guys get coupled down into the drive line down here. So the shape of the code looks similar to the shape of the powertrain. Okay, then we go ahead and run some simulations, and let's see the results. So in this exercise, I am comparing to a technical paper, and so we look here, the miles per gallon combined for city and highway over the cycle, 26.6 miles per gallon. It was supposed to be 26.7, so that's pretty much spot on for the level of information I had for this. And we can look at the city and the highway miles per gallon. If we look at the hybrid, we can also pull that out, 30 miles per gallon over here. And we expected from the technical paper to get 31. Now, question. Does anybody feel like the fuel economy for a hybrid vehicle of 31 miles per gallon sounds a little low? Yeah, some people, any hybrid owners in the room? Awesome. So this is actually very fascinating, and this goes back to this your mileage may vary type of thing. If you just do hybridization of the powertrain without taking into account all the other loads and all the other things going on, you get 31 miles per gallon. What is the Prius doing that gives it a miles per gallon? I think the latest one is rated at 50 or something. I don't know, something like that.
Higher the city than on the highway.
Gets higher, right. And there's different things that are going on. Is the latest version as well?
The Prius C gets 50 city, 40 highway.
Okay. So what's going on there is the Prius is able to take advantage of a different type of internal combustion engine. So I'm going up to the hybrid electric powertrain. I'm going to use a new internal combustion engine data that's going to be pulled in. This is for an Atkins-Miller cycle, which does some different things with the compression ignition to give you a higher efficiency across the band. So we're going to add that. Let's go back up as well and change some of the other parameters. So the frontal area for the Prius, this is not going to matter too much. That's just slightly different, but they have a better aerodynamic drag. Let's put that in. And they are lighter than our reference vehicle here, doing some weight reduction. And I know I have one other thing I need to hit. Bear with me here for 1 second. Okay, the accessory loads that are on the vehicle are lower as well. So let's pull those in, hit save. Oops. And let's go back and recompute. 50 miles per gallon. So this is the point. This is the point that you can, it can get confusing with all these things. So we need some way to say, this is what these folks are doing technology-wise. What does it mean in terms of the energy that I'm gonna have to pay? If I'm a fleet manager, I'm paying for the fuel for my vehicles. What does this mean for the fuel I'm gonna have to pay for? How much does that vehicle cost when I first purchase it, and how much is it going to cost me over the life? That's what we want to know. So getting back to the slides here, let me just wrap this up. Wrap up. So about the project, the current status, this is very early work, but I'm extremely excited. This was done as a proof of concept for me. I wanted to see what could Clojure do in this space to sort of help me out. Very excited. I see all the awesome ideas that you guys are implementing, and you know, I think there's a lot of areas where you know, core logic could really, really be used to great effect in trying to make sense of the rules that vehicles need to use in control strategy parameters and making, you know, try to make those specifications easier to put in. I think there's a lot of things, you know, maybe even core async or something. There's a lot of exciting technologies. But this is kind of, you know, very early times, but looking forward to interacting with people. This will be put up on GitHub in the next couple of weeks or so, and you know, hoping to get some collaboration with other people who are crazy like me looking at this sort of stuff. This is actually the fourth vehicle simulator I've worked on, and so I'm hoping to get this one right. The first one I worked on, it was at NREL. It's the Advanced Vehicle Simulator called Advisor. And that's actually an open source project as well. And part of the impetus of really doing this is trying to address some of the limitations of that simulator. I wanted to just end with a little bit of why Clojure. You know, I think this philosophy of simplicity is huge. I think the notions that Rich has shared with us, I'm just blown away by it. You know, again, compared to how the other simulators have worked, the ability to pull things out in isolation and look at them is huge. And you know, part of the problem, I've had some excellent conversations here at the Conj, and many people have asked about, you know, some of the real high performance computing that's going on in scientific computing. And that's great. There's some awesome folks who are doing, you know, MPI and supercomputers and all that. That's not a space that I need to be in for what I need to do. But what I find is the time it takes for engineers to put a model together can be the biggest cost. And so I'm trying to, you know, think of ideas that can help us in that area. And I think simplicity is key. I think another thing, I think this topic has been mentioned by many speakers, but just to maybe say it a different way, a guy by the name of Larry Burns, who's the former vice president of R&D at General Motors, he came up with this concept talking about the power of and. And he was talking in the context of transportation. There are all these different transportation technologies out there, and unfortunately, sort of, there's certain groups that are going, rah, rah, electric vehicle, rah, rah, ethanol, rah, rah, whatever. And he's saying, no, no, no. He says, let's think of and. Let's think of this toolbox. Let's try to understand all these technologies and realize there are different optimal solutions depending on who you are, what you're trying to do, and you know what your situation is. And I think Clojure embraces this philosophy. And you know, the last thing is the community here. I mean, I cannot believe the amount of innovation that's going on in this space, and you guys should all pat yourselves on the back. This is amazing what's going on here. I feel like I've wandered into a conference of wizards, and I'm sort of the young acolyte. I just want to say a big thank you to Rich and the Clojure community, and I also want to give a shout out to the local Clojure users group back in Denver, Den of Clojure. The folks at NREL and my friends at Big Ladder Software who sat through some early versions of this presentation, poor folks. And I'm going to end with that and just sort of leave this slide up on the board. This is, again, Larry Burns, and he just had a nice quote at one of the recent ARPA-E energy summits. I think we're poised for a huge potential renovation and kind of new thoughts in the transportation sector. And I think we're going to start seeing a whole lot of overlap, even more than we're seeing already, between the IT community and networking folks in transportation. And I'm excited. I'm an optimist. I think there's a lot we can do, and there's a lot of great things we can do with that. So with that, I'm going to end, and let's see. I have 6 minutes, so if we have any questions.
Do you plan to extend your model towards so you get
yes.
One vehicle, and then fleet to the lifetime of the fleet, and what are your plans?
The question was whether or not I will be extending this to the capability to do cradle to grave analysis. So the full life cycle cost, I think, is kind of the idea. The answer is yes, but the way I'm really tackling this is I sort of don't want to get into an application too early. I really want to be a library. And so I would like to add that sort of functionality to the library. So if you want to do a life cycle assessment, you could plug into this library and do that. Whereas if you're doing something else, you wouldn't have to do that. Any other questions? Yes. So the question is, what one or two things would make Clojure better for me personally? I started looking into Clojure almost 2 years ago, and using it sort of, this work has all been done sort of in nights and weekends as a work of love, so to speak. But, you know, I've been amazed at the changes in the last 2 years in terms of tooling and that sort of thing. I think there is a need for, some of you remarked I was using Lighttable. There's definitely a need for people like me who are having trouble with Emacs to kind of be able to come into this space. And I really thank the Lighttable folks for stuff like that. In terms of the language itself, I'm getting better at it, but you know, when I have an error message, it's sometimes a little overwhelming to try to figure out what I actually did wrong. But other than that, it's pretty good these days. I mean, I think I would love to see more people like myself getting into this space, and I think I'm maybe a little bit of a forging a new path. But I think as more people get in and look at it, I think, you know, the libraries will come along and stuff as well. But being on the JVM, having access to Clojure script is huge. Yeah, so not really too many downsides. Could you repeat the first part other than... So the question is, other than the energy consumption, are there any other domains where this model would work for? I think, so one of the things that I do, it's sort of funny. So I'm working with Clojure here with this work. In my paid work right now, I work in Fortran. So I'm sort of wondering what's really happened with computing over the last, but anyways. I think there's a real need for, especially for sort of niche applications that are surrounding various simulators and stuff. I think there's a lot of complexity to be found that could be decomplected. You know, so the question was, object-oriented seems to be a good domain for simulation. You know, what were the challenges and trials and tribulations going to Clojure and more functional? You know, it's sort of interesting. My programming coming through as a mechanical engineer was, I was one of the lucky ones. I got to learn C in my school as opposed to the rest of the folks, Fortran. Actually, I don't know if that's lucky, but... I guess what I was going to say is most of us are trained in more of an imperative style, and we're working with the mathematics of our domain more often. So I think folks like me who are doing programming don't necessarily have maybe as strong as an object-oriented bent, at least in terms of like the kind of modern Java-style object-oriented type of thing. So I didn't find it as hard. It seemed, I think once I got my mind around mapping higher order functions and stuff like that, it seemed like you could translate the equations directly into this pretty straightforward. And there's somebody up here.
Have you tried to say
So the question, that's interesting. The question was, have I tried starting from miles per gallon and solving for the other parameters, working it backwards? I haven't. What we've done typically when we're looking for something like that was we'll do a design of experiments or some sort of parameter sweep. So we'll sweep a design space with brute force and just vary the different parameters and see what all the different numbers are. And that'll end up with sort of a contour map that basically gives us the same information. But yeah, as I see some of the interesting things with running, you know, logic engines forward and backwards, yeah, I don't know if there's something more that can be done there. Okay. And it sounds like it'd be it. Yeah, thank you very much.